while I was in university. I studied pharmacy at the University of Ibadan. And I spent 5 years in those ASU strike. Okay, so the first incident was with my project supervisor in my final year. And I had a relatively smooth sale. I was an A-ish kind of student. So, I mean, I was good. I was no issues. I was not really the party type at all. So, I mean, life was good. I faced my groups and were good. So, final year, final semester to be precise, my project supervisor suddenly realized that I had something to offer. He felt that I had something to offer him in exchange for my grades for my project. Let me backtrack a bit. When I was in second school, my mom shared her story. She also had a case of sexual harassment by her project supervisor as well, very funny. So I mean, that was somewhere in my mind when this man started harassing me. He would delay my work, he would always ensure that I stayed for longer. He'd tell me, okay, come to my house. One time he told me I should come on a Saturday morning, his house. He has a library of plenty of books. I mean, I'm sure the books that you need for your project, I have them in my house, come on Saturday morning. And of course, I'd learned from my mom. My mom, by the way, she's an extremely tough woman. Well, I mean, straight as an arrow. Even though we never really agreed, I knew what she stood for. I knew she wouldn't want to hear something like that and not react. So I had in the back of my mind that, you know, if things got out of hand, she was somebody I could talk to. And you know, I like what Dr. Dasilva said about talking to your family first. Even if you talk to your family and they don't do anything, let it be on record that you spoke to your family. Okay? So when things began to get out of hand, I was lagging behind in my project. Other people were moving forward and he wasn't. And he told me to come to his house. I went to a guy and another lady. Who would go you? Okay, now. So I went like two other people. You know, I was always blocking road for the man. Okay, so but I saw that I wasn't going to really make a headway. And this was going to affect me. I had been studying for this pharmacy and it was going to be a good country after a long time. So when I saw that this man wasn't going to let me be, I spoke to my mom about it. And as a Yoruba Christian mother, she said, hey, that's what happened. Don't worry, we will deal with the matter decisively. We enter the relationship basis and we'll do the right thing. I said, I feel amazing because I know that she's my mom, very, very troublesome. So he said, "Don't worry, don't worry, we'll get to it." I said, "Okay, no problem." So the Sunday after, she gave me a call and told me, "Don't worry, it is settled." I said, "What is settled?" He said, "That man will not disturb me again." I said, "Really? What did you do?" He said, "I said it is settled." I said, "Okay." I said, you need to tell me so that when I go and see the man on Monday, you know, I need to kind of be prepared and all that. So I probed her and all that. She said, okay, that what she actually did was she went to the man's house on Saturday, like that was the day before Sunday, and she went bearing gifts. Then she went with 10 yards of lace material, one bag of rice. And I'm telling you my story, right? Yeah? Okay. And a gallon of vegetable oil to appease the gods. Now, I'm going somewhere, guys. So, I mean, so she gets to the man's house. Well, she does her own research along the way. She goes to the man's house Saturday morning. And on getting there, the wife opens the door. And on opening the door, the wife, falls on her knees and was just beating my mom. What a mini man. He said, no, I don't remember you. God bless you. God bless you. I don't know you. She said, ma, you taught me in federal school of arts and science. My mother said, really? hates you. You are bad. So, I mean, all the drama and all of that. My mom said, okay, David, so she sat down and said, she will see. I said, no, I just want to see our supervisor. This supervisor has been such a wonderful man. So, she said, I cannot find you. Let me go and call you for you. So she went upstairs to call him. You know, the man took like 12 and a half minutes to come downstairs because I mean, he was, I'm sure he had like pee in his pants. Yeah? What would talk about him? Who's his mother? He's looking for after. I know what I've been doing to him. You know? So he comes downstairs with one leg of sauce. That's what my mom said. He came downstairs. I mean, he was scattered. He was like in a mess. Came down with one leg of stockings in his hand. And he just comes to me. So when my mom saw, as soon as my mom saw him, she fell down on her two knees and began to pray. She said, my father, my God, this man, as you have been taking care of other people, my God will take care of your own children. My God. She began to pray. My mom is such a drama. You know, so I mean, so she went on and on and on. You know, but the man couldn't say amen. The wife would just say amen. The wife would say amen. The wife didn't know what's up. And you know, and all of that. So she said, oh my God, my daughter, you have been so wonderful. How you have been giving her material, in fact, God bless you. See, that's all I came to do. I have one auntie in there, only your lady once. I just said, I don't want to wait for convocation to appreciate you. I said, let me appreciate you and God bless you. So she dropped everything and went. On Monday when I got there, the man called me. He's like, did you discuss about us? Remember, I'm like, also us. As how? Where is yours? From where to where? So, I said, no, I didn't. Me? No. I didn't. I said, what happened, sir? I said, because your mother came, I said, my mom. You don't know her. That's how she does. I hope she did not talk too much, but she talks a lot. Like, you know, I said, it's doing the gift. I said, that's my mom. Life for these things, you know. That was the next one. The next one was my postgraduate. I don't know whether they sent those letters. But I mean, it's the reality of what it is. And when I was much younger, I had a low cut as well, second school. I'm the second of four girls. I'm not the prettiest of the four of us. So I grew up feeling like, I had some esteem issues. I didn't feel like I was the most beautiful. I didn't expect anybody to, there was a tendency for people to prey on all of that, but there was something that happened to me early in secondary school. And I like to say this because it formed the backdrop of some of the experiences I had and how I was able to handle them. I had a near-rape experience as well, which I'll talk about briefly before I stop this afternoon. I found a relationship with God that made me understand that I was loved. I was worth it, I was valuable, or I am valuable. And that made me able to handle the male advances, the harassment, the near rape experience I had that came several years after. For me, that's the background. Understand that God loves me more than anybody can ever do. And that I'm worth it. Nobody can come to me and tell me lies and just, you know. So for me, I just wanted to drop that there. So in my postgraduate years, I was already married, I was with my second child, and my previous professor also suddenly, I've done all my exams and all of that, and my previous supervisor just discovered that, you know, he wanted to stress me. I was absenting about almost 30 topics, just kept saying, this is not the right topic, blah, blah. What is this about? So after some time, he started asking me, Mr. Akinyemi, you and your husband, you sleep in the same room. I'm like, I don't have the book. I said, I don't understand. You know? So he began to harass me and all of that. You know, sometimes I would go with as many as 17 topics. He said, no. It's not I'll go with, at the time I started writing the project, he chose the topic. At the time I spoke with a friend who wanted to go with army men and deal with the man. My heart did not take it. My Christian mind could not handle it. I said, no, I'm going to build. You know, and what And for me, that was what I had to give up. Very painful, my guys. Very, very painful. Because I studied pharmacy, and the course that I was doing my master's in was managerial psychology. I was transiting into HR, sales business development. And I, you know, you look like something, and I enjoyed it. It was a course I enjoyed. And I aced all my courses. It was just projects, guys. Yeah. I mean, at least that was giving me a very tough time. So I couldn't convince people. I mean, some people who heard my story recently have been gingering me and telling me, no, you can go back to the lab. I mean, they can help you. I mean, this is like 12 years after. But he said, no, we can lose it up, you know, we can get it out and ensure that, you know. So it's my project 2020. I want to see if I can do that. But I have to give it up. At the point, I have to just give it up. So I'll revisit that. So maybe if Sworte talks call me again, maybe I will announce you if I've been able to. Yeah, if I have my master's in managerial psychology, because I really enjoy it. So that's the second. The third, I will not go into more detail, it was more of a harassment, it was by a campus fellowship pastor. Yes. And you know, the style that this man used, the man almost got me. Small time, like, that had to be done with speed. What? Something is about to happen here. You know? So next thing, change is there, he wants to, it's a problem he has. I should pray with him. I should pray for him. I said, sir, let me be going. When I get to my room, I will begin to pray for him. So I'm not saying this so that we would have issues with pastors. They are solid pastors. They are solid lecturers. But I mean, we have to have an antenna up. Finally, the nearest incident I had happened a year before I got married. And it was by two guys who blocked me on the way, who stole my phone. I mean, you've taken my phone, you've taken everything. I'm just, let me go, as it were. They didn't let me go. They said I should remove my clothes. I said, I should remove my clothes. We die here. I will not remove this clothes. So I've kept this myself since all these years. It's now I remove clothes. No, I'm not going to remove my clothes. So they beat the hell out of me, guys. They beat me. I'm sure they beat me to the point where any erection they were going to have was not there. I don't know. That's where, I mean, when you have used all your energy to finish between somebody, or maybe, I mean, the way I can say it really is that it was divine. Because at the end of the day, they beat me. When you crepe somebody from under and the person's head landed, my clothes were torn, they pulled me, slapped me, beat. After I was like, what is this with you, really? You know, so we are not going to have our way with you today. I said, I beseech you, just kill me. Keep me here, we die here today. You know, so I mean, and that's my encouragement to somebody. I prayed before I came here today, and I know that I'm speaking with at least one person. And to corroborate what Dr. Dasilva said, you have the power. Even when it seems as if physically, because this guy beat me, I was in the hospital physiotherapy for about a week, guys. Yes, as in, they beat the let's just not go there. And when I think about it, I'm like, why did you just allow them, you know, for me, guys, they beat me, you know. But we have the power, even when it seems that, I mean, you're losing out, you're, you know, the person has power over you, you still have